Have you seen my exclusive Disney Epic Mickey 2 The Power of 2 interview with Warren Spector yet? If not, get on it! The guy is a legend and he goes into great detail about the game. Now, my Epic Mickey interview was conducted at Gamescom in Germany during a roundtable chat with other journalists who all took it in turns asking Warren questions. Being a proper interview thief, I filmed the whole thing, and rather than just leave the footage to gather dust on my hard drive, I decided to edit his fascinating and lengthy answers into some standalone videos so you guys can get a peek into this gaming luminary's mind. Definitely watch this if you have ever thought about making a game. There's loads to learn here, but it's also just plain cool to listen to his opinions on everything ranging from working with Disney to level editors in games. For this first part of my Warren Spector special, I decided to jump on the nearly dead cloud gaming service on live and record myself playing a little bit of Deus Ex, possibly Warren's most well-known and well-loved game. Enjoy!
The secondary unit should be online soon. It's currently undergoing preparation and will be operational within 6 months.
So Warren, what is your magic formula for making a perfect video game story?
The critical thing for me in a game story is, and this is just for me, I'm not saying that this is the way all games should be, players have to be able to surprise themselves and the designer. Like, let me give you a specific example of what I won't do as a developer. I finished two games last year. Human Revolution, Deus Ex Human Revolution, surprise, and Heavy Rain. Okay. I thought Heavy Rain, as a player, I loved the experience that Heavy Rain gave me, you know, but I would never make a game like that. And I think Heavy Rain worked exceptionally well because David Cage is an exceptionally talented writer. And he was able to write 5 movie scripts. I totally made that number. It might be 4, it might be 17, I don't know. But he basically wrote a bunch of movies and mashed them together and made that all work. I mean, it's an enormous choose-your-own-adventure book with lots of beautiful pictures. And the end result is amazing. I mean, as a player, it was one of the most powerful experiences I've had. But there, it is not possible, near as I can tell. I'd like to actually sit down with him and talk to him someday. But I don't believe that anything could possibly ever happen in Heavy Rain that David didn't specifically script and an artist didn't specifically draw pictures to support. And in my games, I know I've succeeded. I know we're ready to ship the game when someone figures out how to do something that everybody in the team thinks is impossible. Okay. Sure. I'm not going to give you the example from this game, but it's happened in the new Mickey game. Because I just want people to figure stuff out for themselves. But there was a moment in the first Disney Epic Mickey game where a designer and an environment artist specifically created a situation to train people that you're going to make choices and they're going to be hard, and once you've made your choice, you're done. Okay? There was a place where you could either rescue a gremlin and make a friend who might help you later, or you could get a treasure from a chest that would make you more personally powerful and wealthier. It's not right or wrong. Which one do you think is the best choice? You can only have one. You want both, you can only have one. And a player figured out how to do both, which everybody in the team thought was impossible. Okay? In Deus Ex, it happened all the time. I mean, all the time. I would watch people trying to solve a problem, knowing what problem they were trying to solve. I'm going to move an explosive barrel over here. I'm going to throw something over there to make a sound, to attract something. I'm going to use a pistol to shoot the barrel when a guard is attracted to... I mean, no one planned that, you know? The player made a plan, executed the plan, and it worked, okay? There are countless places like that. I mean, we created an object called the LAM, a light attack munition, that you could attach it to a wall, and if an enemy showed up near it, it would blow up, okay? but it wouldn't blow you up if you got near it. So what players figured out was they could put a lamb on a wall, jump on it, because it was a physical object, put another lamb up here, jump on it, reach down, grab that first lamb, put another lamb, put it up there, jump on it. And they created what we called lamb ladders. And they were getting out of the world, and they were getting places in ways that we didn't anticipate. And I just went, feature! You know, I mean, that's awesome stuff. So players are really good at that kind of stuff when you give them the opportunity. But players are absolutely terrible at, you know, that three-act structure, why what you do is important. You know, so what I want to do is I want to own, it's your brother. He's being held prisoner on the other side of this door by terrorists. You've got 5 minutes before they kill him. If you burst in, they may kill him anyway. What do you do? You know? Like, basically all you're doing is, you're saying, you control a white pixel, put it on that brown pixel, press a button at millisecond 32, and that white pixel will turn into a red pixel, and a green pixel will move 12 pixels over to the left. That's all you're doing, okay? And the description of that situation by the player is going to be, I did this, and then I did that, and then this happened, and then I did this other thing, and then this other thing happened, and this guy came in, and then I did this. And it's a horrible story. What makes it a great story, well, great in air quotes, right, is it's your brother. He's being held by terrorists on the other side of this door. You've got 5 minutes to save his life. I want to own that, you know? I want to own this point. I want to own this point. These are little plot points, you know? Your brother's being held prisoner. Rescue your brother. How you do it, I just don't care. And I want you to surprise yourself. I want you to surprise me. I want you to surprise the artists and the designers who built that level, you know? And I don't know anything about this idea that you were describing, but if it doesn't allow for that kind of surprise, it's a waste of time and people should stop doing it. If it does, more power to them, because frankly, I would love there to be a better way to tell interactive stories that really put players in control, so you know every player ends a game having had a unique experience.
Yeah.
That's the big high-level direction I give to all the designers. Every player has to get through your level describing something unique, you know? And if it does that, win. If it doesn't, not interested.
Were there any differences between working with Disney and working on your other games?
You know, there aren't as many differences as you might think, because all creativity happens within constraints. I mean, for years I've described my most important role, I guess, on the projects I work on as I'm the guy who creates this creative box. I'm the guy who says, these are the boundaries within which the team will work. And as long as they stay within those boundaries, they can do whatever they want. It's kind of the way, actually, I think about the role of players in a game, you know? I don't care how you accomplish these goals, but these are the goals you're going to accomplish. That's what I tell my teams, too. And so I put constraints on J.C. Denton. I mean, it was like if a designer came up with a fun way to put a pie in JC's hands and said, you know, he's going to pie, you know, Manderly, his boss, I was going to say, no, that's not going to happen. But with Mickey, putting a pie in his hands might be exactly the right thing to do. You just have to find the heart of the character, part of the thing that you're trying to create, whether it's original or licensed, and be true to that. The number one thing you have to do with a licensed character is find out where that creative box is. And so it's just a question of negotiating with the people who created it or own it or control it. And that's what I've done. I mean, with Disney, it's been a really powerful negotiation. I mean, they believe really strongly in a lot of stuff. And I believe really strongly in a lot of stuff. So we've done a lot of, you know, this. But we always end up in a place where we're both happy. And I was stunned, frankly, at how open Disney was to ideas. And the amount of freedom they gave us was pretty remarkable. But it was just a question of not screwing it up. You know, there's a reason why Mickey is about the only thing I can think of that, you know, mainstream audiences still care about from 1928. You know, there are niches, little cults of people who still watch silent movies, like me. And there are little cults of people who listen to Paul Whiteman and his orchestra, or Bix Beiderbecke and, you know, the Wolverines, but most normal people don't know anything about that. Everybody still knows and cares about Mickey, so they're doing something right. And I didn't want to screw it up.
So it was just a question of negotiating where the boundaries are.
Seeing as you're so keen on player choice in games, what do you think of games with level editors? Would you ever be keen on making a game that includes an editor?
You know, I started in tabletop games where, you know, Dungeons & Dragons and GURPS and Toon, the cartoon role-playing game, you know, all games I worked on back in the day. What we do is we give you the tools to create your own stories, your own interactive stories that you then tell with your friends. I mean, that's the whole point of tabletop role-playing. And I've spent the last, you know, 30 years trying to recreate that feeling and that experience in an electronic game space. This is a true story. The day I started at Origin, I went from TSR making tabletop games to computer games at Origin. The first thing I said to Richard Garriott was, why don't you release the Ultima 6 editor? I saw it for the first time there. You know, it's like, here's this incredibly powerful tool for creating game worlds. Why don't you release that and let players make their own games? And the response I got, not from Rich actually, but from the business guys at Origin was, why would we spend the money polishing this tool when we would spend the same money creating a game that people are gonna pay us to buy? And so we never did it, you know? I mean, that was in 1989. It was in, April of 1989. And to this day, I don't understand why we didn't do it back then. But I think it's a great idea. Here's the thing, I'll tell you, here's where I was completely wrong. I remember when the guys at BioWare said they were releasing the Neverwinter Nights editor, and I thought they were crazy. Because I said, like, okay, here's the when I was at TSR, here was what we learned. There are about 15 million people who played D&D when I was there. Of them, 10% became game masters, so 1.5 million people. Of them, 10% created their own modules, their own adventures, so 150,000. Of them, 10% were okay, so you got 15,000. Of them, 0% were publishable. We got submissions all the time from amateurs. None of them were good enough to publish. Okay, you're releasing the Neverwinter Nights tools. None of them are gonna be publishable. But I was completely wrong. Okay, what stunned me was, first of all, a lot more people played with those tools than I expected, and a lot more of them did great work. So now you see people doing it all the time, and I mean, I won't hire a designer anymore who you know, can't show me their mods, you know? It's like training wheels for professional development. So I was completely wrong about that. Releasing tools is a great thing. I came in with the idea that Origin should do that, and over the course of years, got convinced that I'd been wrong, and I should have stuck to my guns. I was wrong, I should have done it. Oh well.
Oh crap, I was pretty bad at that. Oh, I didn't know what the hell I was doing there. Oh well. Make sure you sub to the channel because part two of this incredible look into the mind of one of the gaming world's most respected designers is coming soon. And he'll be talking more Disney, his love of tablet gaming, and what his view is on today's gaming industry. See you then.